What's good, YouTube? It's your boy Go Williams, man, back with another reaction video. Back with another boxing reaction video. But this time, it's gonna be top 25 punches that will never be forgotten. I was going through videos, seeing what I could react to. And I seen this, and it had 54 million views. So I know this video good. Let's get straight into it, man.
Welcome back to the greatest knockout series in YouTube history. Punches that will never be forgotten. In this series, we dig through our personal archive to unearth some of the single greatest punches that have ever landed in a boxing ring. Hopefully, by now, most of you have seen part 1 and 2. And for those of you that didn't get to see part 1 before it got pulled for copyright, by the time you finish watching this, it should be back up for everyone to enjoy.
Boxing Legends TV, highly suggested channel.
Great channel.
If you enjoy this series, please remember to hit the like button, as it really goes a long way in helping this channel.
They do not play about their copyrights, bro. Music videos.
During the summer of 2000, two fighters, Ben Tacky and Roberto Garcia, were both in the rebuild stages of their careers. Nothing but a victory would get things back on track, and entering the 10th and final round, was ahead by a wide margin on all three of the judges' scorecards. Tacky knew he needed a knockout to win, but he did more than just knock him out. He spun his head around and earned the Ring Magazine KO of the Year.
KO of the Year. Ooh. Oh, yeah, he's done. Yeah, he's done. Oh my goodness. People gotta have some reaction time, bro. I feel like he's getting beat up before that.
Delivered for $6.99 each, as well as lava cakes, bread bites, and more.
When Evander Holyfield ventured to the heavyweight division in the late 80s, he had some huge boots to fill.
I realized that
I fought with him on Fight Night.
I'm gonna fight Mike. He's the only person that I watch always fight.
The former cruiserweight champion ran through his first six opponents with ease, and when he met the Mike Tyson conqueror, James Buster Douglas, for his first world title shot, he ended him swiftly with a perfectly timed straight right counter.
That was clean. That counter. Weave.
In the long list of videos from my channel, I think this might be the very first time putting together some Butterbean footage.
Butterbean? See, I went on Fight Night, and I scrolled through the fighters, and I look at Butterbean. I'm like, is this a joke? I don't know nothing about Butterbean. Somebody let me know. Is Butterbean cub? For real?
You're tough. I'm tough. It's going to be a hell of a fight.
I'm going to go on Fight Night.
Butterbean was pretty much a freak show in sports entertainment. He competed in boxing, kickboxing, MMA, and even WWE events.
What? He that big doing kickboxing and MMA? I don't got nothing against big people. I'm just saying, like.
There was a small period of time in the late 90s where the WWE actually featured real boxing on their shows after the fallout of Iron Mike.
I can see
and it was
WWE.
Here where Butterbean landed one of the most savage overhand rights you'll ever see on the unfortunate Bart Gunn.
Not gonna lie, just looking at him, he looked like he can throw hands for real.
It must have been exciting for Jim Ross to commentate on a real contest for once.
He knocked him clean out. That man wasn't even trying to get back up.
During the fallout of the heavyweight champion Rocky Marciano in the mid-50s, a new face emerged, one who appeared much faster and visibly skilled than anyone before.
Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness.
In 1956, Patterson became the youngest heavyweight champion of all time at 21 and held that record for 30 years before Mike Tyson broke it. However, Patterson's journey as a champion came to a halt when he was...
Bro, think about how dangerous boxing was in the 1900s, bro. And really have, like, the technology we got now. I mean, they still have some technology to help recover with injuries, but not like now. Man.
Beaten up and brutalized by the heavy-handed and undefeated Ingemar Johansson in 1959. The rematch was scheduled a year later, and the bookmakers rightfully had Patterson as an underdog going in. But he got his revenge, and he got it in brutal style.
Nice,
specifically didn't want to do that. I didn't want to make any mistakes in this ring. So I didn't want to give anyone a chance to say that I was a dirty fighter.
Oh my goodness.
Floyd Mayweather has never been known for having concussive punching power, and it's mainly due to his hands slowly breaking down over a long and prosperous career. But he shocked the boxing world in 2007 when he matched up with the 43-0 ultra-aggressive Ricky the Hitman Hatton. Hatton tried his best to rough up Floyd for the early rounds, but it didn't faze Floyd. And in round 10, he set the perfect draft for the check hook.
Floyd avoided so many losses, bro. Oh my goodness, that was clean.
Emmanuel said that Ricky brought out the best in you.
Well, I guess he did. All right, thank you.
That's for sure.
We've had some funny looking faces on the canvas in the series so far.
Eyes wide open.
Stunned, and some even zombified. Anders Eklund also fits well in this category after taking a brutal overhand right from Tim Witherspoon in their 1989 clash.
231 pounds. Oh, big right. There goes Eklund. Oh my goodness. He trying to fight it.
Big shot like this lands on the temple. It's simple. Game over for anyone. I know this one will still be fresh in the memory for many viewers here today, but there was something about the ferocity
that
gives me the impression
like
it will live on for a long while to come.
In the end, at the end of the night, I win every single time. I do all my visualization and I always win.
In January of 2017, the pound-for-pound unbeaten star Mikey Garcia moved up to lightweight to challenge for Dejan's Latikanen's WBC title. Between them, they had 57 wins and 0 losses. Someone's O had to go.
Why did Mike change like that? Oh.
The term blink and you'll miss it is a bit overused in today's game. How about blink and you'll score the luckiest knockdown of your career? Well, that's exactly what Danny Garcia did to the speed demon Amir Khan back in their 2012 unification clash.
Khan is extremely sharp.
Khan was dazzling him with his rapid hands throughout the first three rounds,
got some
and then
hands.
Garcia swung for the fences.
He ate that hit.
Khan somehow made it to his feet, but was stopped soon after.
Boxers really do not want to stop fighting. Oh my goodness.
Sugar Ray Leonard was a phenom in his prime, and don't let anyone tell you otherwise.
Sugar Ray, look at those hands.
Look at them hands. Oh my goodness.
Pound for pound, one of the fastest
boxers ever.
He's
just standing there.
But unlike a lot of other quick-fisted fighters, Leonard used to put a lot of weight behind his shots. Perhaps none landed better in his entire career than when he nearly took Dave Boy Green's head clean off in their welterweight title bout in 1980.
Oh my goodness.
The way Leonard used his full body to generate the power is frightening. Literally, his feet were
clean in the jaw.
Meet Randall Bailey, the boxer that goes by the nickname the KO King, and it's certainly not a fabrication. With 39 knockouts in his 46 wins, I think it's fair to say he is one of the most underrated punchers of the modern game.
How hard is that a boxing ring floor? I can beat your head on it, like how hard? You know what I mean? Like, would it hurt? Sometimes you can't do nothing about getting knocked out, bro. You gotta take that, bro. But for like when boxers walk down the street, do people be like, "Oh my gosh,
Klitschko
you got knocked out"?
Is one of the biggest and scariest heavyweight boxers of all time. People like to downplay his resume and refer to his style of boxing as boring, which is fair enough. But you can't say anything about the man's brutal punching power.
Oh my goodness.
He has 25 world title defenses with most ending by knockout. But for me, the single greatest punch he ever threw was against Kubrat Pulev in 2014.
Holds up for the moment to that punch.
Yes, Pulev.
Down goes Pulev on another left hook.
The perfectly placed camera allows us to see the skin ripple on Pulev's face as his head hits the canvas. And the 60 frames per second capture always looks great in slow motion.
Oh yeah, that man looked like he died.
Has anyone ever wondered what happened to Jermaine Taylor? In 2005, he became the undisputed middleweight champion by outmaneuvering the Hall of Fame legend, Bernard Hopkins. A few years later, he was battling away against the likes of Kelly Pavlik, Carl Froge, and Jeff Lacy. In 2014, however...
I never lose to another white boy.
Okay.
85 plus live channels with no hidden fees. YouTube TV,
why you
try
gotta,
free.
Why you gotta put it like that, bro?
How you feel?
Come on, man.
It seems like he might have lost his mind a bit, and I've got a weird feeling it had something to do with his truly devastating knockout loss to Arthur Abraham in 2009. Check it out.
Ain't nothing wrong with losing to another color, man. Another culture, man.
Just in case you didn't hear it, listen closely to the horrifying noise coming from Taylor as he lays on the ground.
Was that him going,
James Toney was the man in the early 90s. He was known for being the slickest of all slick fighters around. Hmm. He could box, punch, slip, slide with staggering ease, and by July of 94, he had built up a record of 45 fights unbeaten, which was the longest streak in the world at the time after Julio Cesar Chavez had just lost his ridiculous 90 unbeaten streak a few months prior. Toney's challenger was Prince Charles Williams, who put up a valiant effort for 12 rounds before having his body...
89 was crazy. Right. Mm. Oh my goodness.
The 2003 toe-to-toe thriller between Rocky Juarez and Antonio Diaz had everything a fight fan could ask for. Controversy, blood, an enormous amount of punches landed, and to top it off, a jaw-dropping knockout of the year by the trailing Rocky.
And it feels like we're in a Sylvester Stallone movie as they chant Rocky.
Beat.
A resounding left hook.
Beat. Oh my goodness.
People often talk about the speed and power of a prime Mike Tyson, and for good reason.
Tyson, laid it on.
Same man that bit somebody ear off, man.
The guy was incredibly skilled in both departments. When he faced Reggie Gross in 1986, he proved patience is the key in finding the knockout as he dodged a dozen.
Who do y'all think will win, Mike Tyson or Muhammad Ali?
Punches before letting one of his own bombs out.
R.I.P. to Muhammad Ali.
I only found out about this knockout recently while researching for one of my videos, and there is no better feeling than finding a hidden gem like this. Check out this brutal one-punch knockout upset from Darnell Wilson on David Rodriguez from their 2013
clash. Rodriguez has never lost. 36-0 in his career.
It's not over. This fight's over.
Wilson has knocked him out.
It's over. 10 seconds left.
Darnell Wilson.
Wow.
And the final round has
already
there will always
the
be
way
a divide between
that.
The fans on which fighter was the best left hook in boxing history.
Oh, man.
Some say Mike Tyson. Others say Joe Louis. But for me personally, it's between Joe Frazier or Tommy Morrison. These two knocked out too many men to name with a left hook. So here are my picks for the top 10 between them.
Lucky them ropes there to hold you up, boy.
Mm-hmm.
They need to add more ropes or something. They is getting put to sleep. They don't got a chance to get back up. Oh my goodness. They don't have a chance to get back up.
And I have to face a right hand.
There's a left hand. They go down and probably out.
Close to exhaustion.
Not Muhammad Ali. Left hook.
Oh, yeah!
No. I know he'll never forget that moment. He knocked out a legend.
We thought we would end the video by bringing you a boxer's perspective on the anatomy of a punch. Deontay Wilder is undoubtedly one of the hardest punchers in the world today. In fact, he might be the hardest puncher between every living human being today. With 38 knockouts and 39 wins,
the only person he can't beat is Tyson Fury.
But the punch on Arthur Spilka,
he cannot beat Tyson Fury. That's irritating.
He did that same look that he'd been doing through the first round all the way to the ninth round. So and I knew where his head was gonna be. So when I saw it, time he made that move, I was on it.
That's a good analyzation.
When I hit him, it was so sharp on his chin, it was like slicing a thin piece of cheese. I barely felt anything. I felt the graze off it. I think personally, I killed him.
Y'all see the way he walked up? That was smooth. Oh my goodness.
Like slice a thin piece of cheese. I barely felt
right into a celebration. Oh my goodness. Off. Ugh.
I think personally, I killed him 3 to 5 seconds. You know, I didn't see him breathing. His chest wasn't inhaling, exhaling. Yeah, I didn't see no movement with the chest. I think for 3 to 5 seconds of his life, I think he died.
Yeah, we need immediate medical attention to Arthur Spilka.
And that sucked, man. Yo, loved ones, like, man, they see you get knocked out like that, man. They know you hurt. You probably got a concussion, all that. You know, now you need surgery. That's tough. Same video of Deontay Wilder. His girl was crying, too, when he got dropped by Tyson Fury. Man, that's tough. But hey, man, this is a good video. I see why I got 54 million views. I got to react to part 2 and part 1. But if y'all enjoyed this video, make sure you like, share, subscribe. If you're new, comment, you know, what I should react to. And I'm out.